Do 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 do. It's Saturday. It's Saturday. Welcome everybody. It is Star Wars weekend. $71 million Rogue One made yesterday. One day, $71 million. Impressive. Okay, I'm not drawing Star Wars though, so it's not like I'm trend drawing here, folks. Not like I just was like, I gotta draw Star Wars all weekend. No, instead, I'm gonna draw Grand Theft Auto. Why? Because that's fucking what has to get done. If you joined last time, I got this far. I laid out this cover easy here. We did it live, folks. Oh, I'm tired. We did it in about 6-7 hours, something like that. I don't know. It's breaks and... So what I did was I sent this cover out to the people in France, and my publishers gave me some notes, and I had to quickly make the changes. I didn't have time to stream it, so I will show you what I did. Went from that to this. So they liked the color scheme, they liked the idea, they just wanted to group the characters a little closer together, and they wanted me to add a bunch of gold bars and cash and stuff to the background. So you can see. I'm not keen on this particular pose for CJ. I don't think they care one way or the other. So I'm going to alter that a little bit as I go along. But as you can see, this is their layout. Ignore the text. But this is like the format they use for their covers. So. You can see. Ba boom, ba boom, ba boom, ba boom. So, a couple notes. They wanted me to scale down the buffness of Trevor. Fine. They weren't sure that was supposed to be Claude, so I kind of moved him out, and then I explained that I'm giving him a little bit more of a Tarantino look because I've always felt that him and Tommy kind of like looked the same, minus the shirts. And then I moved Nikos and CJ up. Kind of increased a little bit of the sizing here. And I pushed the guns. Oh, I didn't. I did switch some of this stuff up, though. So, there you go. Now, what next, right? Well, see, the trick to this is these changes were done. Let me show you. These changes were done using a flattened version of this, right? So I take this, I duplicate, and then I cut out all the stuff. So let me go ahead and get rid of that. Just turn all these layers off. And we can kind of walk through what I do, right? The first thing I did was I cut out all the characters. So if you cut out the characters, let me turn this on. Cut out the characters, and then you fill in the background behind them with a color of the background. So as I move them around, this gets filled up with that solid color, right? And then you sort of paint on top. Like you rescale and you just sort of paint to kind of fill in the edges. And you can see here, I just kind of blocked in some color for CJ's face. Right there. Which, I don't know. I'll work that out. It's not perfect. And then I cut out different elements and kind of moved them around. So it's just manipulating, cutting out and manipulating the images and then painting in, repainting in the background. Just digitally with round brushes. It's not anything difficult. So, but I didn't. Yesterday I didn't have the time to stream this. I had to get this shit done. So, we'll have to do that again sometime in the future so we can get that covered. Alright, so what next? Well, now I need to actually draw this. And I think the best thing to do is to take my initial lines I drew and kind of match them up a little bit, and then give this a pass before I print it out and draw the final art. So I'm going to open up my previously layered Rev3 file. I'm going to grab the lines so I don't have to do a lot of extra work. If I can figure out where the fuck those lines are. That looks like the lines. Nope. Let me just select. Let's turn off all the filtering. Mental note, I need to name the lines layer in the future. Okay. So we grab the lines layer and we'll drag this over. And right now, this is the old stuff, right? So I gotta kind of like go back here and cut these guys out individually and line them up. So pretty simple to just take your lines and kind of like line them back up to the changes that was made. And then we can build this back up. So we'll just hold off on that for a second. Yeah, I'll just sketch this shit. Fuck. Hey, what's up, Hector? Hey, I appreciate it. It's all part of the plan, man. I'm trying to work. I'll get more and more acting into my characters. It comes back to like my animation roots, you know. But Especially as we get into the sequential storytelling, you know, part of the fucking equation. So I'm just, my goal is in the next year is to kind of like just mix all the details I've been doing, you know, and the more of the character acting, and get the books out, you know. And leave the pinup stuff to like sketches and commissions and whatever, you know. All right. Who knows, sometimes the plan works. Yeah, well, you know. You'll see a lot more of it. I mean, sometimes dudes just need to look like a badass. Like, I'm not gonna add a bunch of fucking expressions to the Predator, you know? Make him look all goofy and shit. Speaking of which, I got a sketch I got to draw this week. It's been a fun week, though, man. I did 30, 40 random sketches on top of all the print shipping and stuff, so. Let's move France. And I'm in the middle of, like, writing Game Cave, so. Interesting part about Game Cave, dude. I'm not going to get into this in the updates, but since you're here, I'll talk about it. But the story I want to tell isn't going to work with the game magazine built into it. There's just not enough pages. The most I can print is about 164 pages to a book before I start to lose money, you know? And the magazine component alone is 64 pages. So what I'm going to do is, I got a simpler story. It's kind of like a setup to the story I want to tell. That will just follow Bombcat getting a job at Game Cave, like her first 90 days. You know, and I won't explain this to people because they'll think they're getting shortchanged and they're not. So all my ideas will be there and they'll just be, you know, like getting to know the characters and stuff. So a bit more of a, like a comedy in that sense, you know. This way, each thing I do is self-contained. I don't want to do something that's like, this is only one part of the story. Get the next issue. I want to be like, you bought it. It's complete. You know, if you want to buy more, there you go. Pegas has a question. Do you have any recommendations when it comes to studying? Studying what specifically? With art, it's not just like drawing. Like color, painting. I think, you know, if you're just starting out, you really got to master construction, basic perspective and construction. And to do that, I would recommend Scott Robertson's Fundamentals to Perspective, Gnome on DVD. Phases. Well, first you need to know perspective, because you need to understand how to construct things three-dimensionally. You know, I think the mistake you can make is just trying to draw faces as outlines, you know? And then once you understand how to construct case in point, like, if they were like, hey, let me turn this up. Let's say, here's how important this is, right? So let's say they like Trevor, but they're like, we want to see more under, we don't want him looking down, we want him looking up. That means I can take the same exact pose and shift it upward so we see under his chin. And that means the top of his forehead would come here and it would come back into perspective. Right? And let's say they wanted him looking down, so then I can rotate it and have him look down. Right? And let's say we want him look over here. We can have him rotate. We can do a 3/4 where you see like the side of his ear and under his chin. Where things sort of stretch, right? We could do a side view. So you see what I mean? Like understanding the volumes. Like I find it easier for myself when I'm designing, once I understand shapes, how to like block in silhouettes, right? So I can take block this in, and now my mind sees this three-dimensionally. See? So like that's, you gotta train your mind to see. So you got to understand how to do that to move the shapes, right? And then once you understand that, now this can take years, Pegas. This can take years. Don't worry about getting Instagram likes or fucking Facebook likes. Understand how to do that, how to manipulate the shapes and rotate them and move them throughout space. And then once you have that, you can then work on expression, right? Even very basic stuff where you're taking these... Where's my sketches? Did I delete that? No, here it is. Where, you know, you can plug in expressions where you can be like, I started with like even stick figures where you just start off with, you know, let's say he's inquisitive, right? This doesn't take years. This just takes studying expressions. You can even use a mirror. Maybe he's mad. Right? And then you learn to work that in their face. How do you work that in their face? Well, then that comes back to construction. What kind of nose do they have? Trevor had, I want him to have a wider nose. Well, I can draw that three-dimensionally. Right? And then the brows are three-dimensional. And this is going to stretch this sort of thing. Yeah. You can even like his ears can go right, so sort of depends. Not all the GTA games, man. There isn't enough space. There just isn't enough space. On cover art, it's not like an 11x17 print where I have tons of space and, you know, there's no text. You can see here in a second. This is how much space I got, right? So. So I picked the main characters from the main. First, I made sure the main titles are there. One from each game, right? So Claude, the most popular character from each game. So Claude, Tommy, Trevor, Nikos, and CJ. Yeah. And then I worked in all the weapons. Because to me, the weapons are the second best characters in all the Grand Theft Auto games, right? So. But if you do that development work, yeah, if you do that development work, man, it pays off. You know, you should spend your entire 20s doing it. So by the time you hit 30, you're solid. Now look, you can just draw the same. There's people on Instagram that have 100,000, a million followers. All they do is just draw faces. So it depends on what you're trained to do, you know, or they just draw robots, or they just draw backgrounds, or they do one thing, you know. But, you know, you spend a good year or two just focusing on construction, and you're going to move much further down the way. If you try to start drawing a style, and this is how I want to draw ears and how I want to draw noses, and you don't understand construction, then you're just going to have to come back to this at some point and learn, you know? Some point you're going to hit a point where you can't grow. You're going to hit a limit. But yeah, I do have an art tips playlist, as Hector has pointed out, in which I cover a lot of this stuff. Specifically in small doses. So if you have, you know, if you just want a recommendation for something to study, I would recommend Scott Robertson's DVD series over at Gnome. I also did a podcast. If you look in the Sketchcraft Art Podcast Archive, there's Art FAQ is the name. You can even do a search on the channel, Art FAQ. And those are a lot of my basic advice I give entry-level artists. It's like an hour-long podcast. Did it years ago, but it stands true today. It's the advice, you know, I was given and mixed in with a bit of my own two cents. Yeah, 25 tips. There's a art FAQ, and then there's another. There's graphic designer ones too. But yeah, it's advice that I just recommend. Yeah, Pegasus. I kind of noticed that because I've been really putting a lot of time in. I've seen huge results, but just nervous. I wonder if there's such a thing as practice. Yeah, drawing outlines is the worst you can sort of do, where you're just trying to remember the outlines of things and then you're filling them in with stuff. You know, train your mind to see three-dimensionally and you can fit any style you want. It's basic animation principles, 2D animation principles, you know. You can have realistic shapes, you can have exaggerated shapes, you know. Otherwise, you're just, it's the problem with people who like focus solely on studying photos. They can get so bound to their photo reference, they can't do anything but take photos. And then what they do is they get in this pattern where they take a photo and then they do that grid, right? And they spend forever just trying to connect all these lines, right? Connect all these lines to this grid and match the photo. And it might produce photorealistic results, but if you sit down with people and just say, close your eyes, right? Or move the photos, don't do anything, and invent something, they're not going to be able to do it. You know, they spend a lot of time trying to go, okay, well, an eyeball is, you go around here, and then you come around, and you got the shape of an eyeball, Right? And you're like, well, what happens if I need to make that eyeball look up? You know, what happens if I need to, squint and close it? Like, what it really is a three-dimensional shape. And then there's realistic eyeballs. There's, anime, right? It's all kinds of stuff. So that's what happens. But if you're going to do any kind of sequential storytelling, you really need to know, because you're going to have to invent it from your head at some point. So, with this stuff back here, I'll sketch this stuff in on the board. So, I'm just going to block in basic areas. For stuff. Yeah. Thanks, Hector. I have like 820 videos, man. So even I don't do a good job of memorizing all the content, Like, I don't know. I know I've covered it. Yeah, there's this channel's filled with stuff, dude. It's growing, I do a lot of my stuff in real time, so there's lots of long form videos where I'm just working and we're talking. And like how you asked this question now, someone will just be watching this and they'll hear that question and go, "Oh, I didn't even know about that." Yeah. Hector's so modest. He's like, "Well, Oh, the time lapse? Yeah, I know. That's why I try to do commentary on all the time lapse now. You know? So that way I can explain during the videos that no one's really drawing this fast. You know. Plus, I forget sometimes, like especially when I'm coloring, I'm like, "What fucking colors did I use?" And I'll go back and watch the video and go, "Oh, yeah, you know." All right, I gotta refigure this one out. Didn't want him mirroring the same pose. But later, Hector. We shift the perspective of the weapon. I find it easier to sketch zoomed out sometimes too, just so I'm not stuck on. If he's holding this here. And his front hand is more like this. This would be here. Yeah, like that. See, so I can just figure out this basic. And see, it's just figuring out the side, the planar side of this weapon. And then I know his hand is going to be here off screen. And then the idea is just to sort of. All right. Also, side note, a pet peeve of mine is when they give African American people, you know, blacks, whatever, lips, but they don't give white dudes lips. So I try to make certain everyone gets the love. I don't like it when black people get the fucking giant lip and the white guys don't, you know? Drives me fucking crazy. So I try to split it up, make sure. See, he's got some, and Nico's has some. And then if they're grinning, I'll draw less of it because sometimes it can get in the way. Like that works. Like, you can do like that. That's pretty cool. But if you're like, that would be too much. Black or white, you know? Because they thin out. Your lips thin out as you stretch them, right? So. Yeah, it drives me nuts, dude. You know? I mean, look, if it's. How do I say this, man? Like. We all have lips. You know what I'm saying? Like, we all have lips. Some people have thin lips, like David Bowie. Some dudes got big old lips, like fucking, like myself, Macaulay Culkin. Would Michael Jackson say, I love Mike, right? Love Michael. But what did he call it? Bee stung lips. You can't do that. Bee stung. You can't do it, Mike. It's not good. You know? It's making life difficult. It's like I try to defend and then bring up the bee stung lips. I'm like, well. David Schwimmer, right? David Schwimmer has big lips, you know? There you go. I only know that because my wife and I watch Friends all the fucking time. Jerry Seinfeld. There you go. Right. See, this goes on and on. You know. Bee stung lips. Right. Man, listen to my Parliament of Funk. I gotta listen to George Clinton when I draw Grand Theft Auto. It's the station I only listen to one station, especially in Grand Theft Auto 5. It's P-Funk. Hit him with that pop gun. Boom. It's my heist music, man. I love it. We can take this. And just sort of manipulate really quickly. I'm gonna draw these all on the board, so I'm just trying to get enough information so I'm not overdoing it, but that I'm not like on the board drawing endless construction. So when I go to draw, I want to kind of have the basics already set up, and that's easier compositionally to do digitally, just in terms of time. I just have to fucking draw this shit. All right, so let me turn some of this stuff off. Sometimes it's not. This is ridiculous. These are these slight curves that just get stupid. They can look a little wrong. Pretty strange because I'm going to be conservative again, so don't find myself playing that much drawing. Hey man, that's how it works. People who make stuff don't get a chance to play a lot of it. You know? You're not going to be beating a lot of games. Like, the way I do it now is I allot a night. So long as deadlines aren't involved. So for me, it's I try to make it, you know, Friday or Saturday night, depending on like my wife kind of plays WoW, so it's Friday night, it's her time on there. And then I'll buy like one game a year, like or two games a year. I use Gamefly so I can try out games. And I'll just try them out for like I'll try a game for 4 hours and then it's going right back, you know? Unless I want to keep it a second week and then it goes right back. You know. So I'll play for like an hour in the morning or I'll read, depending on what I'm doing. I try to read more. Although now I'm getting both because I got the Witcher novels. So, you know, like I'm technically reading, but I'm also technically playing the game when you think about it. Like, because they're just adapting a lot of the story straight from the first two games and those novels. So, I get. Yeah, Witcher was one of those games. I was like, I don't know, man. I'm not into AAA gaming. So like, I like Grand Theft, I like Rockstar and stuff. But The Witcher, I was like, oh, I'll give it a shot. And I was like, this is fucking awesome. It's Game of Thrones meets Star Wars with Jedi Knights, basically, you know. Yeah, I don't care about spelling. We don't worry about spelling here, man. We gets it. We know what you're saying. Add zombies and magic. Yep. Well, they have zombies in Witcher. So, I mean, in Game of Thrones. So, it's technically what the. So, what I'm trying to do is just build this vault safe three-dimensionally. And you see how, like, I'll even add the little grid lines here so I can see the surfaces of how they curve around. This is an imaginary line. I'm not going to keep that in the final art. So we know the vault comes out here and it's going to kind of go down like that. And this jail cell, I'm just leaving basic lines because I'll add the thicks and figure them all out on the board. That is so annoying. So, slight problem. We can check right now. I'm going to take this locking mechanism and center it a little bit more. Then I'll duplicate it and center it more and just rotate a little up to compensate for the perspective, which I can sort of eyeball now since I have a pretty good understanding of it. You don't have to be 100% accurate with the perspective. 80% is probably the general rule, the better rule, because that's going to be, see, that's going to be hidden. So I'm going to actually move that down a little bit. The reason for that being that if it's a little too perfect, it tends to look mechanical. You should start drawing digital or wait till I can draw start traditionally on a page. Here's the thing. I would learn traditionally with your perspective, and with digitally, I would kind of practice painting. So scan in your pictures or photograph them with the phone or something, and start to learn to paint or do your value sketching. Value sketching being black and white, so that you take your shapes, right? Let's say you've figured out how to do spheres, right? You got spheres down pretty good. You know, and you do some different spheres and shit, right? And cones. And then you take them in, and digitally you start rendering out light. So you figure out how to build a base. And you can start to apply like light sources. And you could be like, okay, you know. Core shadowing, shit like that. So it's not the best rendering right now, but you get the idea. Start to paint and learn how to paint over those things topographically. Like, so you're still using, you know, I like to start with the basic hard round. So you understand now, like light, I'll turn that opacity down. So you take your drawing and you start to go, okay, if the light's coming from up here, then I know if there's a nose, the shadow's gonna drop under the cheekbones, it's gonna drop under the chin, probably over here it's gonna be in shade, so forth and so forth. So paint digitally. Learn to render light. Painting's about rendering light and form. You just stick with that for about a year or two, man, and you're going to grow exponentially as an artist. Guaranteed. Now, for me, I like kind of older school hand-drawn stuff, like PlayStation magazine covers from the 90s, you know, comic books, Capcom art, the older stuff. So I kind of like still drawing. I like the lines, is what I'm trying to say. I like line art. So a lot of people digitally paint now completely because it's faster, because you can kind of be scribbly and looser. So if you're going to do concept art in games, you really need to get down digital painting, you know, because it's just faster. You know, drawing line art takes a long time, you know. But the reward is you get the line art. Like for me, it's just something I really like to do. But if I were going to if I was just going to do straight concept art for games, you know, do the line art for yourself, but really start learning to be a digital painter as well. So sketching things out traditionally, scanning them in, and then painting over really quick, and then rendering light, especially value, because in game art, you have to change colors. And if you understand the value, then you can change the hues pretty quickly. You know, it's irrelevant whether it's a red shirt or a blue shirt, you know, the value drawing's done or the value painting. So, but game art doesn't really reward a lot of line art drawing. There's just not a lot of time for it. Yeah, definitely loose sketching, because you can, like I said, scan it in, you know. But I gotta fix some stuff with Trevor. There's some stuff going on that doesn't look very good. So I need to take this and move it up and then increase the length of his leg. So same length, I just need to break this down. Trying to see if there's anything else I'm missing. I'll just mask this out. All right, so this is the background. Let's group that together. And, oh shit, where'd I put that lip? I want to keep that, but I put that on right there. All right, then I'll make that 50% lighter. And this sort of compositional stuff, believe me, not a lot of people go, man, I can't wait to watch Rob spend like an hour or two just fucking doing that. That's going to be amazing to watch. Like, it isn't. But it really does make a difference. So when this is on the paper, I'm not spending forever refiguring this shit out. I want the least amount. I just want to have a guide. I want to sit down and be able to just draw the shit out of whatever is there, you know? I don't want to. And then let me check that against my initial. You got to make certain that when you change stuff, it doesn't. Yeah. The game boxes I'll draw digitally after. So there's two phases of this. I'll print this out on the board, I'll draw the lines, scan it back in, and then do digital inks on top, which will clean up the lines and add extra details. So it's faster, because right now if I did it all digitally, I'd still have to do one more pass plus a cleanup pass. So it doesn't really change the effort. All right. Boots upside down. we'll have to make sure that these lines are open. Open, open. Don't like a lot of clutter. Alrighty. Thanks, Chad. Alright, so this is ready to get printed out. I'm going to go take a break and clean up my kitchen. I made beef stew last night. The fucking kitchen's a mess. And then I will print this out, and I'll be back on in about an hour or so to start drawing this. This is a cover. This is a cover for a gaming magazine in France, Armando. This is going to be their next issue. To ignore this, this is temp text. So this is the approved layout. They're doing a retrospective on GTA, the 20-year anniversary of the first game. So I made some changes. I got some feedback. This was the initial sketch, and then they had feedback. So so it goes from this to this, and then we go back and line the lines back up to my changes. And I think I need to increase the size of Trevor's face just 10%. Let's go and do that really quickly. It's just, his face is a little small. I tend to draw faces small, by the way. I don't know why. I tend to draw heads a little smaller. It's a great way to make a guy look buffer, by the way. Like, little trick, right? So if you got a guy who's about, you know, Bruce Timm style Batman build, right? And you're like, I want to make him buffer. You can do that without making him buffer. Just make his head smaller. See? Now he's buffer. Little trick. You want to make him a little bit more normal, or, you know, just make his head bigger. Yeah. So, little tip. That looks a little better. Thing to remember too, when you sketch digitally, the line widths are thicker than they're going to be on the final stuff when you first start drawing. So you're going to actually end up having more space than you initially sketch in. And you got to sort of compensate for the extra space. You'll run out of space when you're sketching digitally pretty quick. And then as you fill it in, you'll end up gaining more space. So there's a little bit of a spatial issue. And that's where you can increase size of characters or position them a little better, so you got a little bit more room for them to show off. Or increase the background coverage. So it's a little bit of a trick. All right, everybody. I'll be back on here in an hour or two, tops. Like I said, I got to go clean up the kitchen, and I think I got to go shovel my driveway. It snowed, motherfuckers. Saw Rogue One last night. We'll be doing a Rogue One chat. I might even call it a review. We're just going to do a Rogue One discussion Monday night. So no discussion here, no spoilers, no topics of any kind. Just saying. I'm going to see you again tomorrow, if that says anything. And then we'll have that conversation Monday. So thanks for hanging out. I will be back fairly shortly, and we'll be physically drawing this GTA cover today, because it has to get done today, and I got to get the digital inks done by tomorrow and flats, and I got to start coloring this Monday. So super fast, folks. This cover is going to get done super fast. Super fast. But drawn well, right? No shortcuts. All right, everybody. Talk to you soon. Peace. Dum dum dum. Sketchcraft. ShopSketchcraft.com.